Marcus Matthiason says, I have high magnesium levels in blood and hair, but low RBC magnesium. I've read through the magnesium section in the cheat sheet, but I am uncertain about how to approach this issue. Worth mentioning that potassium is also low. I get sufficient amounts of magnesium and potassium from diet, according to chronometer, and I've been taking an additional 600 milligrams of magnesium in the form of glycinate / malate leading up to the test. What do you think about this? So, okay, the magnesium in the blood and the hair is high. And so when you say blood, I'm assuming this is serum or plasma because the RBC magnesium is low. I'm hoping that's not whole blood magnesium, in which case it would be hard to separate from the RBC magnesium. But even if it were whole blood, if the RBC magnesium is low and the blood magnesium is high, then the magnesium that's in the blood that's high is in the serum or plasma, not in the RBCs, obviously. So look, this means that you're deficient in magnesium transport. You're not deficient in magnesium. So the last thing that you should do is start blasting high dose magnesium at that, because not only is it not going to help, but you're basically at 2 or 3 times the risk of harm from supplementing high dose magnesium, because the harm of high dose magnesium comes when your serum levels go to double the upper limit of the reference range. So if your serum level's high and your RBC is low and you start blasting, I'm going to rant again. So look, you did the right thing by using the cheat sheet to measure both the RBC and the serum. What I've seen other people do in the past is only measure the RBC. And they do this on the basis that people say that the RBC is more sensitive to deficiency. That might be the case. But if you have a problem getting the magnesium into the cells and your serum is high, then that means that the problem is not, first of all, the problem is not that you're not taking enough magnesium, it's that you're not getting into the cells. So there's a problem that you're not fixing. But the other problem is that if the magnesium can't get into the cells and it goes into the serum instead, then for every given amount of magnesium that comes into your diet, you're going to raise the serum more than you otherwise would, because it's going into the serum instead of the cells. And when it crosses the threshold of twice the upper limit of the reference range, that's where you get into clinical hypermagnesemia that can cause hypocalcemia, can cause hypokalemia, can cause palpitations, cardiac arrhythmia, slow heart rate, fast heart rate, a lot of things that can go wrong at that point. So you definitely don't want to fix this with high-dose magnesium supplementation. You have enough magnesium and potassium from diet, and you've been taking 600 milligrams of magnesium is probably fine. But you want to keep your first goal is keep serum magnesium far away from double the upper reference range. So if it's like 10% over the top of the reference range, the 600 milligrams of magnesium is fine. It's probably putting you in a better situation than you otherwise would be, because if you took that out, probably your serum would be lower and your red blood cells would be even lower, right? So you don't, it's just slightly elevated. So you don't want to be anywhere near double the upper reference range. But if you're a tiny bit over the reference range and you can bring your red blood cells up even a tiny bit through supplementation, then that is okay. What I'm talking about is if you look at the red blood cell level and you say it's not high enough, and so you up the 600 to 1,000 milligrams, and you say it's not high enough, and you up the 1,000 milligrams to 1,500, you say it's not high enough, you add up the 1,500 to 2,000. Tob asks, hypercalcemia. No, I said high magnesium can cause hypocalcemia, low serum calcium. But anyway, so the magnesium supplementation is fine as long as it's not bringing you anywhere near top the upper reference range. But then you want to work on things that affect magnesium transport. Chief among those are salt. So your potassium is fine. What about your sodium? Salt is number one. Vitamin B6 is number two. I have no idea why high dose B6 increases red blood cell magnesium transport, but it does. I'll have to look into that further. In the meantime, all I can say is that there's studies showing, I think they were using 100 milligrams of P5P, if I remember right, Yeah, but Marcus says my B6 status is sufficient, but Marcus, I don't know why B6 does what it does. So that doesn't mean that 100 milligrams of P5P isn't going to increase your magnesium transport. I don't know the mechanism, so I wouldn't rule it out. So salt, B6, and insulin. So if you're not insulin sensitive, you need to work on that. If you are low carb, carbs might help. B6, even if it's adequate, maybe try 10 milligrams, work your way slowly up to 100 milligrams of P5P, see if that helps. If it doesn't, you probably have a more serious issue with magnesium transport. You might have a rare genetic defect in a magnesium transporter. Off the top of my head, I'm not sure how to manage that. There's probably things you can't do. And it might come down to just maximizing all the different possible ways that you can get magnesium into your system and cells. And that might mean that you want a modest hypermagnesemia. In other words, that you want your serum magnesium to be a little over the top of the upper reference range in order to try to drive magnesium into the red blood cells, but you still need to measure it regularly so that you know that you're not anywhere near twice the top of the upper reference range. And then just do what you can to maximize the other factors. Insulin, salt, and B6 is what I think there. So thank you, Marcus, for your question.